Some days it'll lift you up, some days it'll call you bluff. Man, most of my days I ain't got enough. And all I know is you're my only hope.
Darkest day, when I'm losing faith, tell me, no, it ain't gonna change. I just need. Hello? You know, you could all hear me, but the people that are listening online, they had no clue. They thought I was just speaking without words. It's good to have all of you here this morning as we have some folks still coming through the doors. We welcome them, and we welcome you that are online this morning into the house of God, where Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and always will be. So, yeah. A couple of announcements for you. They're in the bulletin. Please take a look at those. Yeah, they're there. These are the same ones that have been in the bulletin for the last few weeks, so there's nothing really that new. We do want to continue to remind all of you about VBS that's coming up in July. It's not too early for you to be asking some kids if they'd like to be involved with that. And it's July 25th, so we're going to do it during the daytime hours. So hopefully we will have some kids come to that. We've already had some sign up, obviously. Also, if you'd like to help out with that in some way, shape, or form, registration, we are going to feed them a light lunch because it's running 11 to 1. So if you'd like to be someone involved with maybe bringing something or taking over one of those noontime lunches for us, see Casey. He's on vacation right now, but when he gets back, you can talk to Casey about that. So Casey and Kayla are on vacation for a few days, so we're grateful that they're able to get away and have some time together. So they'll be back. Actually, he'll be back here next Sunday, but he left on Thursday. So anyway, hopefully they'll have a good time. Announcements are in the bulletin. So he will be, by the way, for his Tuesday morning, he recorded it. So it will be on Tuesday morning, just as always. So it'll be there for you if you want to go in and listen to that. We do have graduation Sunday next week for those who are graduating. I have on the list at this point in time Ruby Bramer, Remington Brown, Joe Buchanan, Tristan Kane, Courtney Tolan, and Clay Yaden. Those are church family members that are graduating. And if you'd like to bring a card for them and bring it next Sunday, I've got a list. If you'd like to take a look at the list of who they are, you can do that. If you want to check with me this week. Beulah asked for their names, so, or you could just talk to Beulah because she's going to have the list. So, so we will be doing the church will be giving them some gifts next week, and we will have a little time for them to. Have a little time to be able to pray over them and let them know how important they are to our church. So. With that, I think that's all I have this morning on news up to date. So if you would like to have a prayer request, I know Alice McKinney is still in the hospital and hopefully going to get out maybe Monday or Tuesday. She will be going to Creasy Springs after that for rehab. So please continue to pray for her. She's still struggling to get herself back together and get things going after her hip surgery. So she's a dear friend of this entire church family. So please lift her in prayer if you would today and this week. Anyone else? Prayer requests this morning?
I have a praise.
Yes.
Our son Dusty.
Yes.
Since he's been here, I think a lot of you saw him one day. He's the one that was battling lymphoma.
Mm-hmm.
But he had his 2-year checkup this past week, and he is all clear. 2 weeks, praise God. Oh,
yeah. Yeah, he was here. He was here about a year ago, probably, and talked a little bit because he's out of Florida. So he's a great young man, too. Yes.
Gene Nichols.
Yes.
And her son, and need prayer for the death of their daughter.
Yes. Gene Nichols, we actually prayed for them in the Sunday school class last week before we left here, but the church, I didn't tell the church about it. Gene Nichols, who, Jerry Nichols was originally from Audubon. He's a friend of many people here. They now live down by Carmel. Jerry passed away 3 years ago in June, and right after that, a year later, his daughter Jill passed away, and then after that, his grandson passed away. And then his only son was in a severe accident, and it all happened in just a short period of time. Severe accident, and he's still not rebounded from that. So if you would lift up Jean Nichols and her family in prayer, she's a dear friend of the Scotts and for Vicki and I. So if you'll just lift up Jean Nichols It'd be wonderful. Her son Jay is actually living with her because he can't really. Yeah, ears ringing all the time and in a back brace yet from a year ago accident. So anyway, a lot of tough stuff. So if you would, and I know there are a lot of folks that need prayer, and I know a lot of you have prayer requests, and you have your own unspoken requests, and those are awesome. Please continue to remember this church. And David, yes. Yes. So John Brettenacher, farmer up north here, very active farmer. Matter of fact, he just finished his planting, or just about was close to it, and I think maybe a stroke or something like that, passed away. John's a great guy. And John Brettenacher, so the Brettenacher family. And also Sandy Brummett from Audubon. Sandy's funeral was yesterday. Gene, you pray for Gene and the kids. It's going to be, they're a really, really close family, so it's going to be really tough on Gene and those kids. So, yes.
This is a wonderful thing. We spent time yesterday afternoon with friends that we hadn't seen between 45 and 50 years. They came to the altar in the first church that Jack served in Michigan, gave their lives to Christ, and have just been dear friends. We sat at an Applebee's for 3 hours.
I've been by Applebee's. You might have been their only customers for a while. It's good. Stayed. What are their names?
Johnny.
First names?
John and Sherry.
John and Sherry. Longtime friends, and good to get back with them, huh? Good, good, good stuff.
Gary.
Yes.
Our cousin Mark is in the hospital.
Yeah.
Yeah,
we've been praying for our cousins, but this is even a different one. He lives down in Texas. He's got a severe kidney disease that he's very, very active. And so thank you for reminding me of that. Mark Vester is his name. So, and his mom's really old, too. Okay, so. Reed's two older sisters that go to IU came back home, and then when they came back home, they brought colds back to the entire family. So Reed and Olive both are feeling a little under the weather, but he wants a prayer for his sister Olive because she's got some fever this morning. So that's a prayer request that you would normally see his little hand go up back here. So, yes, Jane. I'm saying, start again.
The schools are closing. It's the end of the school year.
Yeah.
For the kids,
yeah.
For the teachers,
yeah.
And the
so what are they going to do for the summertime and be safe? And yeah, that's a great prayer request. We got Jane's asking for prayer for the kids. That's as summer school is upon us now. We got just a few more days. Crystal wasn't even sure how many more days there were in her, but she's only a teacher. So why, you know. You know, Crystal, I always knew exactly when school was going to get out. I always.
And I lied to her last week. I thought I had 10 more days. Well, that's because they told me I had 10 more teaching days. They're still finals. So I still have 9 days.
But Jane's prayer request is for these kids as they get out for the summer, and, you know, they're going to be out and about, and, you know, are they going to get the proper nutrition that they need, and are they going to be safe, and those kind of things. So. That's a great prayer request this morning. So, are we good? I know you all got many more, but oh, Marge. Marge had a birthday celebration yesterday at the Friendship House, and just about the entire Friendship House came to her birthday party. Vicki and I were blessed to be able to be there for a little while with her. But I'm not sure if I'm supposed to say how old you are, but on.
I can tell you.
They're 40 days apart. And Beulah turned 92 on April 7th, so you figure out the math on that one, okay? Never a dull moment in this building, is there? God is so good.
Amen.
He is so good. And I thank you for the Marges and the Beulahs of the world. Let's pray. Father, I'm just praising you in all things today and giving you the glory today for this day of life you've given us. Even for those who are preparing to wed over the next month that are here in this building right now, I lift them up to you. As their marriage begins in June for Avery and Forrest, I pray for them. And for these prayer requests, Father, that you've heard go up all over this building. Praises, prayers, to God be the glory. Because of you, Father, we can be here freely today, Father. And we can pray to you, and we can fear no evil coming through the doors at us because you are here with us. So today, Lord, we just praise you in all things. Thank you for the corn that's starting to peek up out of the ground. For the trees that are starting to bloom. Signifying new life. But yet, Father, we know in the midst of this new life, there are still that are leaving this earth to be with you in paradise. And we do lift those families, the Bremets and the Bretnockers, to you today. And praising you for friends that show up and spend hours with us. For good reports from the doctors. To praise to you, Father. So Lord, I lift our graduates as they prepare for the end of the school year and as they prepare to go into that next chapter of their lives. I pray they take you with them. Because we know you will be near. So today, Lord, in this building and outside these walls, we're going to praise you and we're going to give you the glory because you so richly deserve it. So today, Father, tomorrow, and the day after that, you will receive that praise. In the name of Jesus, your Son, our Savior. All God's people said. Amen. Slade, I think you're reading. I always hope that's not a surprise.
To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O God, I trust in you. Let me not be ashamed. Let my enemies not triumph over me. Indeed, let no one who awaits on you be ashamed. Let those be ashamed who deal treacherously without cause. Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. On you I wait all the day.
And if you'll rise, let's sing. The church's one foundation.
And the word.
and will continue with nothing but the blood. And if you'll have a seat, Brian's going to lead us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, we just come to you grateful for another beautiful day. We thank you for the sunrise and the sunsets, the rains. We thank you for the blessings that you give us continuously. We just pray for all those who are here with us today, that we'll never forget the sacrifices that have been made for us. Be with our children, keep them safe. Be with those who know you and those who don't. Let us always have an open heart to share the good news with them. We pray for those who are in countries where there is unrest and that where missions like the Unchained can help them, Uncaged, I'm sorry. And we just pray that they will have the purpose to continue on to do the good things that you have planned for them. Father, we just thank you for the word that Gary will give us today. And we thank you for Pastor Casey and hope he has a wonderful vacation and comes back to us ready to fill us with the good news again. We just pray for those churches that have kind of fallen away, that they will come and repent and come back to you and wholeheartedly worship you as we all try to do our best. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen.
Hey, why don't you take a moment and welcome the person around you, behind you, in front of you. Just say hello to them this morning as we get ready to start the sermon myth. We're going to be in the book of Mark today. I wish you all liked each other. That's great. By the way, today the weather's getting nicer, so if you, after church today, if you'd like to fellowship outside for a little while, you're welcome to do that. I know the Sunday schools get started, but we do have Sunday school for the adults in here. And we have the youth downstairs on the west side. And in the kitchen study, we have the little kids, although I think we got a couple of them that are not feeling well today, so they're probably not going to be with us. But I think Dan might be the teacher today. Is that right, Dan?
You wouldn't be able to announce
it. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So, you know, I don't think there's an age requirement, so if some of you want to go down and just see Dan teach, go. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for this moment you've given us, where we get to open up your word. We get to read from your word. We get to study your word. We get to find out what your word tells us that's best for us to do today, tomorrow, and the days ahead. Father, this is a sinner saved by grace that's your messenger, but it's the one you put here today. May you be with him. May you speak the words you need through him. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We are going to be in Matthew, so if you have your Bible with you, and I hope you do, you can, and if not, there's one probably in front of you. It's an NIV, but I'll be reading from the NIV, so you're welcome to use that Bible. If you've got one with you, follow along. It will be up on the screen, of course, for all of you here can see it as well. Online folks can see it on the screen also. We are in Matthew, and I will tell you before we start, just like I try to tell you about every time we do a scripture, it's good for you to go back and read some things before you get to where we're at. And I will tell you, the book of Matthew 13 got a lot of parables in it. It's a lot of stories in there. And so if you go back and take a look at the very beginning of 13, it starts with the parable of the four soils, and it talks about the parable of the weeds, the parable of the mustard seed, the parable of the yeast, and the parable of the weeds again, the parable of the hidden treasure, the parable of the merchant. This is all in 13, before we get to where we're at today, which is the parable of the fishing net. And so I've titled this message today, The Kingdom Net, because we're going to talk about fishing a little bit. And I really wish Tristan would have been here today. I was going to talk about him but since he's not here, he's fishing today, right? Since he's fishing, it'd be appropriate to talk about fishing today, right? Tristan is I know several of you are fishermen, but Tristan is our guy that does competitive fishing, so I'm very proud of him. He's a great kid. Let's begin in 47. Matthew 13, 47, and maybe you'll see where we're headed here today. As it comes up on the screen. Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up on the shore. Then they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad away. This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throwing them into the blazing furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things? Jesus said. God's word for God's people. Interesting, isn't it? If you look in Jesus' time, it's very common, fishing was obviously a very common and important activity. And in fact, obviously, we know many of the disciples. As I look across this group of people, you know many of the disciples were fishermen. Thus, Jesus saying, come, I will make you fishers of men. But many of the Jesus parables actually involve fishing. There's conversations about it all the time. Obviously, they were in the area of the Sea of Galilee where a lot of his ministry was at. So fishing was kind of the thing. So it was kind of something to talk about. It was something for him to use as a parable. It was a way for that people understood what fishing was about. So it was a good way for him to relay his message to people. And so that's what we tried to do today. As I was reading through this, I got to thinking about, I'm really not a very good fisherman. You know, I got family members that are. I mean, my brothers are fishermen. My nephews are. My son is. My grandson. I used to fish a little bit with my dad when he was alive, but I was not a big fisherman. And I love eating fish, by the way. So in case you have extra. Actually, Brenda's husband, James, stopped by my house one day with some bluegill and dropped it off. I live at Boswell, and... But I started thinking about, okay, what's it take to be a fisherman? What do you have to have? What do you need? Yes, Slade. What?
Patience.
Patience. First thing on my list, patience. You've been reading my notes? Oh. Patience. And when I did fish, I'm not very patient, so you can imagine what that was like. You have to have some skill too. You know, you really do have to have some skill to fish, and because you kind of got to know where to go and what to do and how to go about it and how deep and how, you know, all the things that you fishermen I'm sure know. You also have to have some mental and physical strength, I believe. You got to be able to physically, you know, pull the fish in. You got to be physically able to be out there probably hours upon hours. And mentally, sometimes it takes its toll if you're doing that. And especially when you look back to what they were doing, many of them were commercial fishermen, you know. This is their bread and butter. This is the way they were going to eat. This is the way they were going to make some money. But even in today, if you're out there fishing for yourself, and also then a willingness to get your hands dirty. You can't fish without getting your hands dirty. It's just all there is to it. They're going to smell like fish. Well, mine didn't always because I didn't always catch fish. But if you catch fish, your hands will be dirty. And then the fifth thing I'd written down was the right tools. You have to have the right tools. You have to have the right equipment to do what you're going to do. And I wrote those down, and I got to looking at them, and I thought, those five things sound a lot like ministry. You have to have some patience. You have to have some skill. You have to have some mental and physical strength. You have to have the willingness to get your hands dirty once in a while, so to speak. And you certainly have to have the right tools. This would be it. This would be the right tool. Interesting that Jesus would make that comparison between fishing and ministry. So before I get too far ahead, you're all thinking this, but I need to remind you. Their fishing was different than what we do today. They used these big nets. We used the line. Well, maybe some of you are using nets. I don't know. Maybe that's how some of you are catching your fish. But I think you're supposed to use a single pole here. Multiple poles maybe, but a single line. And back then it was all nets. And what did that net do? That net was thrown in. It took some physical ability to be able to do that. It would go to the bottom of the lake, and it would drag the bottom of the lake, and it would be tied on each end, and it would drag the, it would scoop up the fish, and then you had to be strong enough to pull that even into shore, or maybe sometimes it was back into the boat if you were in a boat, right? So that's the way they caught fish. So all kinds of fish would get caught in that net, right? Because they weren't just fishing for bass, or they weren't just fishing for crappie, or they weren't just fishing for king salmon. It's one of my favorite TV shows, by the way. But I digress. Have you ever watched Alaska, the Last Frontier? It's about the only thing I watch on TV anymore. My wife will tell you that. It's these homesteaders that are up in Alaska, and they have to survive off the land, and they fish, and they catch these huge king salmon. And I'm thinking, wow, just the strength. Sometimes they pull them up through the ice even, so. But to pull these fish up with a net, you're going to get every sort of kind of fish, every type of fish probably that's in the lake. And in 47 and 48 that we read up here earlier, it said, once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. And when it was full, the fishermen pulled up on the shore. Then they sat down and collected the good fish, but threw the bad away. Jesus says the kingdom of heaven is like a net. It's like a net. I had to think about that for a little while. And I guess, in effect, maybe as a pastor, I throw out a net to pull in all kinds of people to this church. This net should be able to bring in anyone and everyone into this sanctuary or online. So dragging it along the bottom of the lake, and I'm not suggesting that we're dragging people in here, but we do bring people in of different species, if you will, different styles, different faces, different ways of life. It's got some similarities. So instead of using a singular line or a spear to catch the fish, the net was simply lowered in and pulled up whatever the net could grab. The fishermen knew where the good spots were at, right? Just as if you're on a lake that you know, you look for the good spots. I was talking to Tristan last Sunday, I believe. He was had been down at Patoka Lake, and he said one of the tough things was he didn't know the lake that well and finding the good spot for where the fish are at. But these guys that we're talking about, they knew the lake, and they pretty much could figure out where they needed to drop those nets. So I begin to ask myself, am I dropping my net in the right place? And I believe the answer to that is, right now, anywhere I drop my net is the right place. Because we should be dragging people in. I'm using dragging, but because the net's anyone and everyone through our door. No matter who they are, they could be homeless, it doesn't matter. I hope this church is a welcoming church to anyone from any walk of life. I believe we are, but it's important that no matter what their walk of life is, they're welcome here. So that body of water that we look at as the Sea of Galilee, it's really kind of representative of all the people in the world. It's important that we understand that that we're pulling people from everywhere and every sort of life. The kingdom of heaven's like a fisherman who casts his line in the lake looking for the perfect trout. No, that's not what Jesus said, was it? He didn't say that. Sometimes we try to pinpoint as individuals that perfect trout, if you will, that perfect, oh, I think they would probably be ideal for our church. I can assure you, I do not know who those people are. God does. God will bring them. As Gary Ishmael will tell you, it's, yeah, you just open up your mouth and talk to the next person. Because you don't know. You don't know where they're at. You don't know where their heart's at. You just open up and you talk to them. I had a really good conversation with a gentleman the other day. It was just about that sort of thing. You know, hey, where you go to church? How's it going there? Just chit-chat. We have to learn to open up our mouths to those people and talk to them, to reach them any way we can. We got to find out whether they're the perfect trout. No, we don't. We have to find out if they need Jesus. John 3:16, I noticed we, as we put that up on the screen, I noticed we use this a lot here. And it's a very popular, obviously, a very well-known verse, but I noticed Casey's used it a few times. I use it from time to time. But it just fits so many topics that we're on so many times, and it's one you probably ought to memorize. It's probably one you should always have with you. For God so loved the world that he gave his son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. You see, I'm getting to the point here to tell you about what we read in the scriptures when we read about that there will be the good fish and there are the bad fish. And the day's coming where God, who is the only judge, by the way, is going to judge who can stay and who cannot stay. That's why it's important that we stay strong and we stay together and we stay in the Word of God. I run into people who say, Pastor, I'm just having trouble right now. I just don't feel like God's close to me. You've heard this before. I've talked to you about this from the pulpit before. And I will tell them over and over, been there. I've done that. And if you get away from this, if you get away from this and the fellowship of others, it's easy for you to get sidetracked. And this world wants you sidetracked, folks. The evil one wants you sidetracked. He wants you off on anything else but the Word of God and what God wants you to do. And it's so easy today to get off track. I wrote down here, one of the reasons I believe this parable is so amazing is that in describing the kingdom like a dragnet, we come to understand the net indiscriminately gathers up anything and everything. In the sea or ocean, this means you have all kinds of species. That's what I've been saying to you. Throw the net out, drag them in. God's going to make the judgment someday where they belong. Our job is to tell them about Jesus. Our job is to tell them about the Holy Spirit. Our job is to tell them what amazing God we have. These kids today are bombarded all the time with things of the world. If I were to line them all up here right now, every one of these kids, they would tell you that. I feel assured that they would. I get feedback from them saying, Pastor, what do I do with this? This is what's going on, and it bothers me. I'm glad you young people are bothered by the things of the world. You need to be bothered by those things. Those are the things that make you think, I don't think that's right. I don't think we're on the right track. I think they're outside somewhere. Even your best friends sometimes, including mine, get sidetracked. I have Christian friends who get sidetracked. So it's important for us to hold on to the Word of God and to this community. And for those listening online, I will tell you, you need to come into the sanctuary once in a while and meet this group that's here. They're great people. People who come here because they want to stay strong in the Word of God. We're not perfect at it. We're far from perfect at it here. But we will continue to follow the Scripture. This picture that I painted for you today about dragging the bottom of the lake or the ocean or whatever you're dragging, get the fish, is just really a good picture for me to envision, because I envisioned that net being thrown out and through this entire community and bringing people into this walk of life that we are on. And it's a picture that we need, because when I read Revelation, if you read Revelation, you know Revelation's really about Jesus, right? Revelation 7:9 says, after this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. Great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from every tribe, from people and every language possible. That's what it's going to be in heaven. You're going to see people from every walk of life. What a day that will be. My Jesus, I shall see. It's an uncountable multitude of people. Every nation, every tribe, people from all over, from every language. I would never want anyone to not want to come in here because their skin is a different color. They're always welcome here. And I hope you always welcome them here. If we would have a homeless person walk through that door right now, I assure you we would have people jump up and go to their side. It's an absolutely beautiful picture of the multi-ethnic heaven that we're going to see someday. So the kingdom is like a dragnet, gathering up all kinds of people. The kingdom of God is like that net, dragging up all kinds of people, bringing them into the knowledge of Jesus Christ. So I got to thinking about this analogy that I was making, and I got to thinking, you know, there's probably some of you out there, when I started talking about fishing, you like, yeah, I'm not interested in fishing. So probably just decided not to pay attention to me. Perfectly fine. That's your, you know, if you don't want to pay attention, that's fine. But I got to thinking about, I only thought about this because I opened up my junk drawer this week. Okay, face it, you've all got a junk drawer at home, right? Everybody's got one. Okay, there's a few over here going, no, I don't have a junk drawer. Come to my house, I'll show you my junk drawer. our daughter from Florida and her husband are up with us now for a little while, and he was wanting something out of my garage to work on doing something he was going to do, and I opened up this one drawer and it was just full of junk, and he goes, "Oh my, we got some work to do here, don't we?" So, yeah, have at it if you'd like to clean that thing. But I got to thinking about that, putting it in the same realm of what we're talking about. There are some times when you open up after a while and it just gets so full, you got, okay, all right, this, why do I have this? I don't need it. So I put it in a pile to get rid of, and a pile, I got to have this, I got to keep it. So pretty soon you take your junk dry. I don't know how often you do yours. Mine's about every 5 or 6 years probably. Clean it out. I don't need that. Why did I ever keep that? Wonder what I thought I was going to do. But it's got to go because I don't need it, right? It's the same thing here that God's going to do someday to all of us. I look at it and go, I don't know this guy's name. I've never seen him before. I don't know why. Do I need him? I don't know how it's going to be. But I know the Word tells me that he's going to make the final decision. Just let me get on a topic for just a moment that's a little, this is the Holy Spirit speaking to us today, because this is not in any of my notes. From this pulpit, we don't get into the homosexual part of life, because my belief is they're all God's people. Everyone has their own right to think how they want to think and do what they want to do. But they are God's people. I am God's person. I am not their judge, and neither are you. God is their judge. What we have to do to all those folks, or any folks that are outside of where we think they should be, is to tell them about Jesus. I don't personally want to say, shame on you. I say, Jesus is my King, and let me show you, hear what he says about that. And let God do the rest. It's not my job to judge people. It's not my job to judge you. It's my job to tell you what the Word of God says the way I see it. And you can always pray for them. And pray for me. And pray for the person next to you. Because this should not be a surprise to you. We are all sinners. Saved by grace. Our job as ambassadors of Christ, which is what we are, ambassadors of Christ, is to join God in spreading the kingdom net by sharing the good news of Jesus. I wrote that in the bottom of my notes. Our job is not to only offer the kingdom to people we see as worthy. Our job is to offer to as many as possible and let God deal with sorting it all out, because that's his job. I don't want his job. I just want to love him. I had a long conversation with one of my daughters last night on the phone. And it's been no secret. I've told out loud that I have a daughter in Terre Haute who's gone through a really, really difficult divorce. And even though the divorce is over, there are children involved. So custody always comes back, raises its ugly head all the time. And it's raising its ugly head in court again this next week for custody. And I talked to her for an hour and a half on the phone. And the last thing she said to me before she hung up was, "Dad, you told me that if I'm faithful to God, He will be faithful to me. No truer words are out there. He will be faithful to you if you are faithful to Him. The truth always wins. It may be ugly, it may be dirty, it may be not where you want it to be all the time, but the truth always wins. And if you read this and you get to that revelation back there, we win. Because we're faithful and we're honest and we're truthful. If you kids don't gain anything out of this today, but what I'm telling you now is be honest. Be honest. It's easy to start with a lie. It's easy to start with a lie. Because it's difficult sometimes to tell the truth. But after these, I'm not preaching at you kids. I'm just telling you that this old guy, 70 years, finally figured out that God wants you just to be honest. He just wants you to tell the truth. And He wants you to be faithful to Him. Always. And in the end, you'll win because He wins. So I wrote these last things down here. How can you participate in spreading the kingdom net? Where do you need to exercise more patience? How can you grow your skills in sharing with others? Pray and ask God to increase your mental and physical ability. Humble yourself and get your hands dirty in serving others. And if you need to spend a little extra money to get some better tools for the journey, I'd encourage you to do so. And if you don't have a Bible and you want a Bible, I will give you mine. You need a Bible. I suggest a study Bible because it'll help you understand. There are also commentaries that you can talk to Larry and Janet Bledsoe about that. Larry's got he's got about 3 libraries full of commentaries or something. He brings them to class. But they're important because they explain sometimes when you don't understand, when I don't understand, that study Bibles have places in where you can go and it'll give you references to go back and reference someplace else in the Bible that will help you. So if you don't have a Bible, let me know. If you don't have a Bible, I will give you. I can't give you this one. But I would. It's got my name on the front because my kids gave me this. But I know my kids, and they would say, "We'll buy you another one, Dad. Go ahead and give it away." You heard it. But we also have a lot of other people in this church. If you ask them for a Bible, I was sitting in Bible study one night, and my Austin was talking about a friend of his that didn't have a Bible, and he was going to get him a Bible. And one of the guys at the table handed him his Bible and said, "Here, give this one to him." You see, kids, adults, the Word of God is the only word we can follow today. The world wants you to think everything else is okay. But not, it's not. Only the Word of God. Only the Word of God. So let's do our part. Let's be sure we start spreading the kingdom net so that we're pulling in everybody and anybody that wants to come through these doors, because it's not our job to judge who they are. It's our job to put them before Jesus and let Him make the decisions on what He needs to know and what they need to know. Right? Let's pray. Father, thank You for this time You've given us. I praise You in all things today, Father. And Lord, if there's someone here today that is questioning the name of Jesus, I pray, Father, that You would touch them, that Your Holy Spirit would touch them in a mighty way today. Because, Father, we know full well that the better we know You, the closer we are to You, the better chance we have of spreading the good news to someone else, to reaching out to someone else. That kingdom net, Father, that we're talking about this morning, that You've given these words to me about, the kingdom net would stretch out even further. The net would even be bigger. It would bring in more into Your name. Not just into Forever Grace Church, but into the church, the church. So, Father, we just praise You. We thank You. We love You in all things. We pray that You would go with those that go from here today, that they would be able to shout out the good news that Jesus Christ is alive, and I felt His presence today in Forever Grace Church. And for those in the churches around us, I pray that there are people coming out of their doors going, praise God, I heard the Word of God today. So, Father, I just give You all the glory. I thank You for this congregation, those that listen online, because they're people that You love so much, Father. May You touch them in a way they need to be touched. May You guide them in a way they need to be guided. And may You receive all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Rise with me and sing, "Oh, How He Loves You and Me." Can you hear me? I'm at least smart enough now to know that the one way that we are going to grow the kingdom together is to know what the gifts are that God has given each and every one of us. That's how much He loves us. It's like, here's a gift. Now go get them. Let's do the kingdom of God together, okay?
Thank you. Thank you for putting your tally, the responses of your gifts back there into that basket. And I'll be going over them. And our pastors and I will be finding a way to touch base with every single one of you who did that. My heart is so full today. It's so wonderful to be back. I have to go to other churches when my husband's going to be in a pulpit. But I'll tell you what, this church is just... No words to describe it, and I'm thankful to be here. Thank you for writing out what your gifts are, and we will continue to let you know what we're going to do with them. God bless you all.
Dr. Bill turned his in, so y'all are behind. I hope y'all know you're loved here. You should know you're loved, because God loves you all. So make sure the guests that are here today are well received. And we got Gabe back with us. Gabe, where you at? You got back from Purdue? You get Purdue all straightened out while you're in there? No, okay, he didn't complain. It's good to have you back, Gabe. So, yes, Ishi.
Sunday school is one of the finest Sunday schools I've ever been in. Each and every person that has been attending is contributing love morsel that you can take with you. And if you haven't been joining us in our Sunday school, you're really missing out on a great opportunity. God is in it. And the Holy Spirit is working wonderfully, and we're letting it happen. And some of the words that come out are going, oh my, that is wonderful. So we just want to encourage you to stay with us after the service and join us for our Ephesians. We're in Ephesians 5.
There's coffee in the basement. This adult class will be up here. The youth will be downstairs. The kids will be in the kitchen study down there. So go and